Thank you all for coming out to meet the Golden Rule and her crew tonight. My name is Jerry Condon, and I have the honor of serving on the National Board of Veterans for Peace, along with Dan Shea, who's here, member of the local chapter of VFP 72. And I'm also a shore support person for the Golden Rule Peace Boat. And I want to welcome you all here. The Golden Rule arrived into the marina close to here, River Place Marina, this afternoon. And we have a number of the crew here right now. And we're going to start the program. We have a very, very special program tonight, very unique combination of wonderful speakers and music. And we're going to start off with music. We have David Rovix. I'm sure many of you know David, wonderful singer-songwriter who's internationally known, and happens, you're lucky enough that he lives here right in Portland. And we thank David for joining us. David's going to get us started.
Stood up 'cause they couldn't stand by. of course, your generation also produced Donald Trump. So, it's not all. He was born a rich man, then he got richer still by bribing politicians on Capitol Hill, by declaring bankruptcy, by working with the mob, by causing lots of Americans to lose their union jobs, by exporting industries to sweatshops overseas, by acting like an idiot on national TV. But now, after his accomplishments, one more impressive trait: he's God's gift to the caliphate. God's gift to the caliphate. In between his beauty pageants and gambling casinos and pretending to be a self-made man in films and TV shows, Donald Trump decided he should run for president. For jihadi recruiters, his campaign is heaven sent. It's a war between religions, a civilizational fight. That's what God says, and Donald Trump says that's right. All you Muslims, stay out of here, just go join Islamic State. He's God's gift to the caliphate. God's gift to the caliphate. Sing along, simple chord. He's not much for statistics, he doesn't have the time. Between harassing men and committing corporate crime. But he's a savvy gambler, he knows how to play the game. He's got a list of groups ready-made for him to play. He doesn't just hate Muslims, he hates Mexicans as well. And he's prepared to win the contract for the wall he wants to sell. But the terrorists around the world think he's really great. He's God's gift to the unknown. But if the past is any indication, then Trump has set the tone. Along with 27 governors, congresspeople by the score, who, if we turn the clock back to 1944, would be turning back the refugees just like we did back then. If that worked out so well, why not just do it all again? Because what the world clearly needs is more bio bombs and hate, and God's gift to the resuscitated and all that, and they started making folks here started making plans to get it back on the water. Then I was inspired to verse, so I'll do one more song before we begin the non-musical segment of the. And blessing me, you guys are going to start singing the non-musical. You know, there's rhythm in it. The golden rule. signatures. Send in petitions. Sometimes you must bear witness. You can't just burn the fuel. So Heaven and His kindness set out our golden rule. You do unto others as you have others. Do unto you the golden rule.
So here we are, we're supported by the earth, and we're reaching for the sky. Our hands can rest comfortably on our knees or in our laps, whichever is comfortable for you, so you don't have to fidget, move them around. And so you can just sit and rest and be still for this few minutes. I'd like you to visualize a mountain. Think about a mountain. It could be a particular mountain, or it could be any mountain. What's a mountain like? It's big. It's rooted in the earth. It's solid. It isn't particularly bothered by anything. It happens. So think of your body like a mountain, rooted in the earth, vast, so you sit, body like a mountain. Now I'd like you to think a little bit about the sea. I just came back from the ocean. The thing about the sea is that it's immense, vast, and it's always moving. It has these waves that come and go. Some of them are fast and some are slow. Some are tall and some are short. It's always moving and it's always part of the same thing. This large ocean. So now we can think of the breath like the sea. So it comes in and out. Sometimes fast, sometimes slow, sometimes deep, sometimes shallow. Body knows how to breathe. We don't have to do anything to teach it how to do that. Just notice it coming and going. If you're on the ocean in a boat or a ship, you make little waves, but it doesn't really affect the whole ocean. The ocean does what the ocean does, regardless of what's traveling on it. And at the edge of the ocean where the waves are, the birds run back and forth. It doesn't have anything to do with what the waves do. They just do their thing. So for a moment, rest. Body like the mountain, breath like the sea. And now think of the sky. Affected by clouds or planes or birds, anything that moves across the sky. It's just the sky. Nothing really affects it. And so our mind is like that. Mind like the sky. Thoughts come up, feelings come up, ideas, visions. It's just the mind, part of the vast mind. So we have mind like the sky. So notice the body like a mountain. Sit like a mountain. Breath like the sea. Always moving. Mind like the sky. Clear. Unobstructed. Vast. As we act in the world, we want to remember this rootedness, the solidness of the mountain. The constant gentle movement of the sea. And the clarity of the sky. sea. Mind like the sky.
Center. I needed that.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to thank a few people before we get into the program. First of all, I want to thank the First Unitarian Church for allowing us to be here in this wonderful space, and also for hosting the Veterans for Peace Chapter 72 office, which is in the basement here, is that right? And I wanted to thank VFP Chapter 72 for helping to pull this together and for all the great work you do in Portland. Education Without Borders gave a very generous donation to the Golden Rule. We also have co-sponsors, and our local co-sponsors include No Nukes Northwest, Alliance for Democracy Oregon. I want to give a special thanks to Nancy Newell, Catherine Kendall, and Malcolm Chaddock, who did a lot of work to pull this event together, and all the others who helped. And then last but not least, KBU Community Radio is a co-sponsor. That's KBU Community Radio 90.7 FM, and they did a great job putting PSAs out over the last 10 days and having several of us on for interviews, and we really appreciate that. Veterans for Peace loves community radio, and we appreciate KBU's support. We're going to launch into the program here. We have six speakers, and our first speaker, kind of our keynote speaker, Harvey Wasserman. Many of you have heard Harvey and speak over the years. He's a long time. He's a long time opponent of nuclear power, and a leading advocate for the crazy idea that we can get our power from the sun. So, with no further ado, I'll ask Harvey Wasserman.
I think it's easier for you if I'm here, right?
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's a beautiful turnout, beautiful place to be. I'm really, really honored. I got to spend 3 hours today coming down the river on the Golden Rule. And I was really disoriented when it ended because I thought that was all of life. It was like I disappeared into that. I'm going to pass this out. One thing, I always love to get emails, email addresses if you're game for being on my Solartopia list or any other lists. I'd really appreciate it. So if you'll take this, David, that would be great. I do have a timer there, so let me grab this and we'll just make sure that I don't go over. I'm going to start talking actually about something that's not on the agenda, which is the election. I live in, have been living for many years in Columbus, Ohio. My good buddy Danny Friedman is here from Columbus, Ohio. We've known each other since the previous century, let's put it that way. And as you many of you know, Hillary and Donald appear to have cinched their nominations. I am hoping that Bernie will run with Jill Stein, and I've actually written her a letter.
Woo!
That if Bernie will run with her, that she can become a Lutheran. Because I don't think the country will elect two Jews on the same ticket. I don't know how she'll respond to that. I am technically the Secretary of Energy of the Shadow Green Party. Jill is a wonderful person, and I'm going to keep it nonpartisan, but I will be voting for her in Ohio. I love Bernie, and Jill is considerably less grumpy than Bernie, I will tell you that. Absolutely true. I got involved with the election protection issue, and I do want to start with this, because without democracy, we don't end nuclear power, we don't end nuclear war, and we don't get the Solartopia, which is a green-powered Earth. So I'm going to talk about elections, and then stopping nuclear power, and what, where we're going to go once we do stop nuclear power. I live in, as I said, Central Ohio. I always wondered why I was there. And in 2004, we've watched firsthand the theft of a presidential election. I will say right now that the one great thing that we can say about George W. Bush is that the United States, the people of the United States, never elected a president. The 2000 election was stolen with the complicity of Jeb Bush, El Jefe of Florida at the time, who disenfranchised more than 90,000 mostly black and Hispanic people in an election that was decided by 537 votes. And in the course of that election, a woman, that was revealed, by the way, by Greg Powis, who had a good buddy of mine, a good reporter, who actually has a very good piece up at Reader Supported News, which runs most of my stuff and can use your support from time to time. And Greg showed in 2000 that these 90,000 plus people had been stripped from the voter rolls. And in the course of the election, a woman named Bev Harris, who I just met for the first time, actually, showed that computer manipulation had been used to flip 20,000 votes in Volusia County in the middle of the vote counting in 2000. So we call it now, the technique is now strip and flip, strip the voter rolls, and then if you can't win that way, flip the electronic vote count. And I will tell you that had Greg not done his reporting in 2000, and Bev and I looked at the electronic vote count in 2000, nobody would have known it happened. I mean, it's kind of frightening to think about it. The two people were really between us and total ignorance on what happened in 2000. I want to strongly fault Al Gore and then John Kerry for not fighting over this, because they both walked away from the election. And in 2004, in Ohio, when Ford, as you know, decided in the Electoral College that George W. Bush would become president, and all these wonderful things like the Iraq War and 9/11 followed. In 2004, John Kerry handily beat George Bush in Ohio. And what happened was, prior to the election, there were innumerable methods used to strip the voter rolls. They took out 300,000 people off the voter rolls, at least, in an election that was decided by 118,775. That's a number that's been implanted in my brain, unfortunately. And we monitored what they did. They did hundreds of things to prevent people from voting. And of course, black people, for example, in the precinct where I grew up in Driving Park in central Ohio, it took black people 5 hours to vote. And where I vote in Bexley, which is a mile away, it took 5 minutes on the college campus where I teach. And these things went on, we know they went on. We call it a Jim Crow method of stealing elections. But that wasn't enough in Ohio in 2004. At 12:20 at night, CNN did a flash screen and they showed that John Kerry was winning Ohio by 4.2%, more than 200,000 votes in a state where 5.5 million people were voting. And suddenly there was a blackout, and there was a so-called glitch, this term glitch. There's two key words in electronic election theft, glitch and recalibration. When you hear those two words, you know the election is being stolen. So at 2 a.m. in the morning, the glitch ended, and suddenly, from being ahead 4.2%, Kerry was behind 2.5%. It was a 6.7% shift of more than 300,000 votes. And that's how George W. Bush got his second term. So I'm not going to go into it too deeply. My co-conspirator, Bob Fitrakis, who is a political scientist, it's a good match. I'm a historian. We are together. We live in central Ohio, but we both vote for the University of Michigan. That's been our bonding. He's from Detroit, and I went to U of M. So then you can't survive in Columbus, Ohio, unless you're a Buckeye fan. Except that, so we have a bomb shelter where we write our stuff. So we put these out. We've written six or seven books now about electronic election theft, and the latest one is called. The flip and strip selection of 2016, five Jim Crows in electronic election theft. I'm not going to go through the five Jim Crows, but you can ask me afterwards. And I do hope I get to meet all of you personally after the talk. That would be really great. But the reality is we do not have free elections in this country. And after 16 years after 2000, it's going to happen again. It certainly happened with Bernie. I will tell you that I am 100% of the belief that if we were using hand-counted paper ballots in the 2016 primaries, and there was no theft going on, that Bernie would be the nominee of the year. But I won't go too far with that tonight. We are starting an organization now, having 16 years of proven flipping and stripping of our elections, that is going to focus strictly on hand-counted paper ballots. And what we want is universal automatic registration when you turn 18. Everybody's 18, you're automatically registered, get a form at your high school or your college or at the DMV, the motor vehicles, or at Costco, wherever they are, and just send it in and you're registered. No photo ID. A signature is fine. There is no indication whatsoever that people are double voting beyond Ann Coulter, who did it. And what all that's required is a signature. It's a five-year felony. Nobody double votes. A couple of people maybe here and there, but it's not a significant problem. We want a four-day national holiday for voting. Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. No work. All you do, the polls are open, 12 hours a day, everybody votes. On Saturday, all the non-Jews vote. On Sunday, the Jews vote. Monday and Tuesday, everybody votes. And then, and finally, most importantly, hand-counted paper ballots. There is no reason not to have universal hand-counted paper ballots. Electronic voting machines are perfectly designed to steal elections. That's what they do. Hand-counted paper ballots are done in Germany. They're done in Ireland. Ireland had machines, by the way, got rid of them. Switzerland, Canada, and I'm not sure what the situation is in Oregon, you can tell me, but this is a national movement. We're going to go precinct by precinct, state by state, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to try and convert the country. Recycle paper ballots or hemp ballots. The hemp ones will keep for 2 years and then you can smoke them. So that's the spiel for getting us a democratic system. It's way more important, by the way, than banning money from politics. We can beat a bad candidate, no matter how much money they spend. We can't beat a bad candidate if they're going to strip the voter rolls and flip the electronic vote count. That's where we're going. So, having said all that, let's move on to nuclear power. There's never really been we have shut one nuclear reactor in the United States in an open election, and that was in Sacramento. They had a municipal utility district. And so Rancho Seco, we voted June 6, 1989, I believe it was, to shut, and my God, it shut. What a concept. We had three referenda here in Oregon, which had a huge impact, but Trojan did not shut immediately after these referenda, which it should have done. We are now in a situation, and I'm happy to tell you, that within the past week, we have had announcements of four commercial reactors in the United States shutting down. Three in Illinois, and Unit 1 in Three Mile Island in Pennsylvania, which was not shut after Unit 2 melted. And I will tell you that me and one other reporter, Anna Mayo, who just recently passed away, were the only two journalists crazy enough to go into central Pennsylvania in the year after the accident. And when people tell you that no one was killed at Three Mile Island, it is one of the worst lies ever told in human history. I spent the worst week of my life in central Pennsylvania, in farmhouses, interviewing people, having them show me their tumors and their lesions and their asthma and their emphysema and heart attacks and a whole other deal. Three Mile Island killed a lot of people. Then Chernobyl killed a lot of people, a lot more people. We believe a million people were killed by Chernobyl, and many, many more after that will die after Fukushima. It is a terrifying arc of accidents. We don't want to think about what might come next, okay? And so we have a Columbia Generating Station here in Washington up the river. Me and German and other people have been working on it. He's going to talk in a few minutes. And it is shuttable. I talked to the man today, the expert. What's his name?
Robert McCullough,
and he explained to me that the Columbia Generating Station is losing tons of money. And that's what's been driving these reactors into oblivion. You know, there will be no new generation of nuclear power plants. That's BS. It's not going to happen. It's a fantasy. But there are 99 now in the United States. In 1974, Richard Nixon said there'd be 1,000 nukes in the U.S. by the year 2000. At the time, there were about 250 online, under construction, or on order. They actually built 130, they actually opened 133, and we're now at 99. So we've shut a substantial number. The number is plummeting fast, but not fast enough, because we now know that commercial reactors can, in fact, explode. The reactors at Fukushima, the four reactors that blew up, were General Electric designed reactors. These are not Soviet Chernobyl reactors. These are American designed reactors. I couldn't see that. What's it say?
Huh? 3 minutes.
3 minutes? You're kidding me. Did I talk that long? Okay, sorry. So we will shut CGS, the Columbia Generating Station. We will do that. It's up to you, though. You need to talk to Mimi afterwards, sign these sign-up sheets. They're losing money. That's the key. That's the phrase you want to hear. They are losing money. And it's your money. It's coming out of the pockets of the people of Northwest. And very briefly, we do now have the alternatives. I wrote a book called Solartopia, which describes a green power earth. The price of photovoltaic cells has been pumped. Photovoltaic cells, which convert sunlight to electricity, will be the biggest industry in the history of the world. It'll be bigger even than the internet. Every home, every building, every vehicle, every machine on this planet will have photovoltaic cells on it, and they are pumping in price, as is wind power, and rising in efficiency. This entire region at some point will be powered by wind and solar energy. If the race that goes on now is, can we shut the nukes before the next Fukushima? That's what it's all about. The picture is laid out for us. We know where the future is with green power. There is absolutely nothing high in the sky about it. It is tangible. In California, there are 55,000 people working in the solar industry. That doesn't even count wind. There are many thousands of people in the United States now, more working in renewables than in coal, and certainly in oil. We're getting close to gas. So, and these nukes, you know, there's 1,000 people working in each one of these nukes. Every one of them will get jobs in the solar industry if we put in the training programs to make it happen. So it's an absolute honor to have the Golden Rule here. It is proof that we can win these issues. You know, the Golden Rule sailed in 58. 5 years later, in 63, there was an atomic test ban. Unfortunately, it didn't go underground, but those didn't until 91. But the ban on atomic testing that came in part as a result of the sailing of the Golden Rule saved millions and millions of lives. Many of us are alive today, certainly our children and our grandchildren, of which I have 10, by the way, because the Golden Rule sailed and it went to, you know, people say, what's a small ship going to do? Well, we know what a small ship did. It really got people's awareness higher. 1963, Kennedy signed, and Khrushchev signed the test ban. The atmospheric radiation stopped, and people lived. And we're now on the brink of doing this again. We have so much promise with us, so many things we can do, that it's a joy to be here to share this with you. And I hope to talk with you afterwards. And no news, everybody. Thank you very much.
Harvey, that was great, and you stayed right on your time. Harvey got twice as much time as the rest of the speakers, so we have somebody here who's going to remind the speakers when they got a minute left and 30 seconds. Thank you, Steve. I want to say that the original crew of the Golden Rule, four wonderful Quaker peace activists, were amazing people, really, really brave. Just the trip they took across the ocean. Was amazing. You know, halfway from LA to Hawaii, they had to turn back because the storms were so bad. They came back to LA and started all over again and didn't make it as far as Honolulu. And then many of them went on to become important activists in the civil rights movement and the peace movement, and very amazing people. However, they had maybe one small shortcoming. They said at the time that they discussed the possibility of having a woman on the crew, and they said no, there's no room on the boat for a woman. So last year when we finally got the Golden Rule sailing again, we found that there actually was room on the boat for a woman.
All right.
Our next speaker, Helen Jacquard, was the first woman to sail on the Golden Rule on the Golden Rule mission. Happens to be my loving partner and co-conspirator and also the project manager of the Veterans for Peace Golden Rule Project, Helen Jacker.
Surprised to find myself in Humboldt Bay working on the boat a year ago, February, and reading the Golden Rule book, Voyage of the Golden Rule by Albert Bigelow, a voyage in, or an experiment in truth. And it was just a random set of circumstances that this non-sailor ended up sailing all the way from Humboldt Bay to San Diego and back, and doing 10 stops to try to educate people that we need to stop nuclear weapons and shut down the nuclear power plants, and indeed the entire nuclear cycle. So it's been an honor to be part of this project and to devote my life to something that I think is so important. And as a way to energize the anti-nuclear movement again, I think it's been at an ebb, and it's time to say, let's do something dramatic to bring attention to this issue. Because there's two existential threats out there right now. One is climate change due to our carbon emissions, and the other is nuclear war. And either of them could annihilate not just our species, but most of the species on Earth. So it's really great to be part of this project. I maintain the website, so if you go to vfpgoldenruleproject.org, on the home page I try to always post a current schedule of our sailing this year, so you can find out where we'll be if you want to find that out. And I also have an interactive map that basically talks about where we're going to be this year. This is sort of who we are right now. One of the things that we face is that people, when I talk to them about abolishing nuclear weapons, they say, good luck with that. And so I'm here to say that abolishing nuclear weapons is not only necessary, but it's possible. So we have a lot of things going on that are, you know, reasons that are people are working on getting rid of nuclear weapons. We have the new United Nations Working Group on Nuclear Weapons. We have the Marshall Islands lawsuit against the 9 nuclear states to force them to come together to negotiate to get rid of nuclear weapons. We have House Resolution 1976 that Eleanor Holmes Norton has introduced to try to get the United States to the bargaining table, get rid of nuclear weapons, and put the money into renewables. So there's a lot going on, but a lot of the public doesn't know about it, and therefore they don't have the hope that they need to have to get rid of this self-fulfilling prophecy about getting rid of nuclear weapons. So there's the original crew. One of the things that inspired the original crew, in addition to the horror of the dropping of the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, was that the same Quaker families were hosting the Hiroshima maidens who came in for plastic surgery so that they could look beautiful again and be able to function better in society. And it really touched them, the way these women came in and learned English and were, you know, it was just heartbreaking that this had happened to them in the first place. So this is part of the inspiration. Yeah. That was Castle Bravo. And that was the explosion that the Lucky Dragon 5 fishing boat was exposed to in 1954. That boat is now in a museum in Japan, and the people that were exposed and ultimately died from that radiation are called hibakusha, just as are the victims of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs. We were doing a lot of atmospheric nuclear testing in the 1950s, and so there's just kind of an idea about who was doing what where. But if you take a look at it, the light blue lines there, that's the United States. So we were doing more of it than anybody else. although the Soviet Union was close behind. Dr. Benjamin Spock wrote about the strontium-90 that was blowing around in the air and causing, strontium-90 is a calcium mimicker, so it goes into milk and it goes into bones. And so it was exposing our children to, especially our babies, to radioactive decay, and who knows what that's caused to our population. It was a very difficult decision, very emotional, for the Quakers that decided that they were going to support this project and for the crew that decided that they were going to sail into the Marshall Islands. They tried everything they could think of. They did petitions, they contacted Congress, they contacted the president, they put articles in the newspapers, they did everything they could think of through the front door, and finally they had no choice but to do Gandhian-style, nonviolent, direct action and put their own lives at risk to sail into the nuclear test zone. There's a lot behind that. So off they went from San Pedro to Honolulu. So you see from Los Angeles, if you go from Los Angeles to Honolulu to Eniwetok, and then you can see where Hiroshima is on that map. The second crew, the crew of the Phoenix of Hiroshima, took over in Honolulu when the Golden Rules crew was arrested trying to get to the Marshall Islands. And they actually were headed originally just to go back home to Hiroshima and had to go through the Marshall Islands test zone anyway. So, wow. They were inspired by the Golden Rule. Oh. Thank you. Well, of course, they got arrested. That was the Coast Guard cutter catching up with them, bringing them back. But their arrest inspired everybody to get involved, do a bunch of protesting. So, fast forward to 2010, the Golden Rule was found in this kind of condition, brought up on the beach. The guy who brought her up thought about using her for firewood. Instead, look at her. Instead, ended up contacting some people and Veterans for Peace and Quakers and other people stepped up. It took dozens of people and hundreds of donors. We spent, so far it's probably been $300,000 to restore this boat. And 5 years of effort. And one of the guys that put in all of this effort is Michael Gonzalez, who's been on the project since the beginning. Please stand up. Michael's been on the crew since the very beginning. And so he was with me the whole time down to San Diego and back, and he'll be on this boat the whole time, all around the Puget Sound, all around, the coastal areas and back this year as well. Let me just briefly introduce the rest of the crew that happens to be here. Captain Norm Peterson, where'd you go? So Norman was the first captain this year, and so he took us from Humboldt Bay to Portland and is now currently training the next captain, Jeff Burke. Stand up. Two of our crew members have gone their way. We have two new crew members that have come on board today. So we have Ren Jacob, four crew members, including Michael, are going to take us all the way up to the river and back, and it's very possible that we're going to do a sail by in Mosher for the train to oil train. So it's going to be an exciting year. We've got 4.5 months worth of traveling to do, and we have at least 30 stops we're going to make, trying to talk about nuclear energy issues, nuclear weapons issues, particularly at the Bangor Nuclear Submarine Base, where they've got perhaps the biggest storage area of nuclear weapons in the world. And we're going to do a combination of educational events and water protest kinds of actions. So you'll see us out on the water with the kayaktivists protesting against militarism all over the Pacific Northwest. And I think I'll say goodbye and you can ask questions later.
Yeah, and we're actually going to be out in the water tomorrow afternoon. Navy parade of ships is coming in to Portland between 3 p.m. and 5 p.m. tomorrow afternoon. And the Golden Rule is going to be out there with a different kind of message. And I think we're going to be joined by a few kayakists and others. And we're going to be meeting at the park. What's the name of the park?
Tom McCall Park
at 2 p.m. tomorrow.
And
it's a huge park, and we're going to be close to the marina. We're going to have a big Veterans for Peace flag so people can find us. But I'm sorry, I can't.
Down the river place.
The River Place Marina is where the boat is, and so we'll be at the nearby park, is the plan for now. If you want to check, try to find out where we are or what the change of plan might have been, you can phone my number, which is 206-499-1220, and I'll give that again later on. Okay, our next speaker is Mimi Gurman, and Mimi is the founder of Radcast. I think she'll tell you a little bit about that if you haven't heard about it before. She's also the co-founder of No Nukes Northwest. Mimi?
I was in Cabo this morning doing an interview, and by the way, thank you to Cabo for all the support for everything that I have. And everything that matters. I didn't have my reader glasses, so I went into the person who was in the back doing the soundboard, and I said, "Do you have reader glasses?" And he said, "A whole drawer full." Thank God for Caper. So we're getting to a place now in this movement, in the anti-nuclear movement, where we are getting older. And it's time now to teach those who are younger than us what is going on. We don't have time to waste with this. This is a really serious matter because we still have new plants that are leaking everywhere. My expertise at this point as a citizen involved in the anti-nuke movement is radiation leaks from nuke plants. My focus is on CGS. And what I know about our background radiation since Fukushima happened 5 and some years ago is that our radiation here in this area in Portland is about 162% higher than it was 5 years ago. It's a big number to wrap your head around. And it means a lot. What it translates into is cancer. It translates into heart disease. It translates into strokes. It translates into bone cancers. And it translates into death. It also translates into DNA changes for future generations. And this is why it's so important for all of us to teach our kids, no matter how old our kids are, and our kids to teach their kids about what this mission is about in stopping nuclear weapons and nuclear power. I always think about nuclear power as a nuclear weapon. I don't separate them. Because when we have an explosion of a nuclear power plant, we have multiple nuclear weapons going off at one time. And that's what happened at Fukushima, it happened at Chernobyl, and it happened at Three Mile Island. We have smaller issues going on at CGS with leaks. I follow those leaks. I follow the leaks. It's a little hop game. I look at what is going on the EPA graphs, and I watch for rises in radiation over periods of time. And I compare those rises in the radiation graphs from the EPA to what's going on the event pages of the NRC. What is supposed to happen, if everything goes correctly, is that a nuclear power plant, when it has a problem, is supposed to tell the NRC, They have a few days to do that. In those few days to do that, we are still getting radiation leaks or whatever has been happening for whatever that particular problem is, which can and often does translate into leaks. Those leaks go out into the environment. The first people that get hit are, of course, in the zone of the Columbia Generating Station, so that's Richland, and then wherever the winds are blowing primarily. What I know is that as of very recently, between March and May, we had big leaks at CGS. Did you guys know that? That's the problem. We don't know these things. The community at large doesn't know these things. And that's why it's imperative for all of us, no matter how old we are, to talk to our children and our children's children and tell them, we have to stop this madness. We have to stop these cancers. We can no longer accept the cancers from happening. I don't care what I'm called in the process of my telling these stories to you or to press or to radio or to anybody. I don't care if I'm called a, pick your word. It doesn't matter to me. What I know is the truth. And the truth is that nuclear power plants leak, and that our nuclear power plant, and it is ours in Oregon, is leaking. It's a disaster. We know this. One of our next speakers, Chuck Johnson, knows this. We all know this because we are very involved in the Columbia Generating Station and the madness that it is putting out into our environment. So we need to shut it down. We have a couple of methods right now. The first method we don't talk about very often, and that's because it's a method that people don't really want to do. And that method is conservation. We can all unplug. We can unplug everything. I'm a fanatic now in my house, an absolute fanatic about unplugging. I make coffee, I unplug the coffee pot if I'm using the coffee pot. I unplug everything that is possible to unplug. I keep my lights off. I sit in the dark. People say to me, well, what do you want? You want to go back to the old days when there's candles? I'm like, yes. If it's that or nukes, yes, I would prefer solar and wind, but you know. So that's the first thing that we have to go by is unplugging. If we all unplugged and we all conserved, who would need nuclear power, especially from CGS? That's first. The second thing is, we now have an initiative. It's called I-855. And there are many of us, there are a bunch of groups put together who are working at from the Oregon level and the Washington level to take this initiative to the streets of Washington, to the stores of Washington, to the schools of Washington, to the churches of Washington, to the Buddhist temples of Washington, to the mosques of Washington, to the, you name it, we need to take I-855 there, and we need people to sign on, which says on this initiative, if we get enough signatures by December 31st for this initiative, this can go to the ballot in Washington, and the voters get to say, do we want this nuclear power plant? I am sure, I've been doing this research, I'm sure that once people in Washington know that there's a nuclear power plant, and that this nuclear power plant is one of the worst in the United States, they will all vote to shut this down, especially when they know what the alternatives are, especially when they know that part of what we want to happen, and it's included in I-855, is taking the workers and helping them to find other work that is appropriate for them in safer areas. Mm-hmm. Safer to us, safer to them, safer to the environment, safer to the children. So you can find I-855 right now. It's going to be in other places, but right now you can find it on radcast.org. That's my website. We track radiation on that website. There's a lot of things on that website. There's information about Hanford. There's things about the Columbia Generating Station, different efforts that we've had so far about what we're doing to shut down CGS. I-855 is on a little tab on the menu bar, and it says Washington State Initiative. Go there. You can download the initiative, and we in Oregon are allowed to take that initiative to Washington and get Washingtonians to sign it. So that's the first question people tend to have, am I allowed to do that? You aren't allowed to sign as a signatory, but you can collect signatures. So you can give that to your friends. This is key. We now have the Seattle City Council on our side. This is a big deal. The Seattle City Council just agreed with a resolution to support the closure of CGS. I'm going to let Chuck, when he comes up, talk about this in a more eloquent way. But the fact is, we finally got the Seattle City Council to say this would be a good idea. The reason that that's important, aside from them being the largest city in Washington, is that they have a lot of power and pressure over the largest PUD in Washington, and that is Seattle City Light. Seattle City Light has a vote as to whether CGS stays up or not. We're pressuring Seattle City Light right now to pull their vote. And then you know what's going to happen? We're going to pressure the folks in Vancouver, the PUD down here across the river, to pull their vote. And then you know what's going to happen? We're going to go to the next place, and we're going to go to the next place. So that's plan two. Plan one is the initiative. So this is what's going on. But if our kids don't know that, we're all sitting here listening to this information. We walk out of here with this information, and we don't do anything with the information. CGS is going to melt down at some point. It is going to explode at some point. There is no way following what goes on at CGS on a daily basis, which is what I do, which is what Chuck does, which is what a few of us do, there's no way that something catastrophic will not happen at CGS. It's just a matter of time. If CGS has a meltdown, we're in big trouble. We're not going to be here. It's going to be, all of that waste is going to be in the river. If more waste is in that river and it comes down our way, we're really not going to be able to be here. This is a truly big deal. It's a gargantuan thought. How do we deal with this? We're going to shut it down. So these are our options. Our options are not to be afraid of this. Our options are not to do nothing. Our options are not to be afraid of somebody calling you something. Our options are not to be afraid of somebody saying, you don't know what you're talking about because CGS is safe. Our options are not to accept anybody who believes that nuclear is safe. A family member coming to you to say, you really, you know, Uncle Bob, you don't know what you're talking about. Because nukes are carbon free. Nukes aren't carbon free. Nukes are carbon intensive. And not only are they carbon intensive in the process of becoming a nuke plant, which is online, they actually release carbon-14. So there's nothing carbon-free about nukes. It's a lie. We have to start understanding that we have been lied to. We have to accept that we've been lied to, take that information, put it someplace in your pocket, and go get the initiative to shut this down. Are we on board? Yes. That you might download the initiative from Radcast. Awesome. Okay, that's great. That's what we have to do. Once we get this going, it's going to be the domino effect. Oh, nobody told me. Okay, thanks for not telling me. Sorry. Or thanks for me not seeing it. So, okay, my time's up. No news.
Hello, baby. You used the time well. Vancouver, I should mention that glad so many of the crew are here. The trip up, you know, from Eureka to here was a long and difficult trip, especially the first part of it. A couple of the crew that made that trip all that way are not here tonight. They had to leave already. And one of them is Kent Mitchell, who lives in across the water in Vancouver. Where we're going to be having an event, by the way, on Saturday the 18th. Anybody wants to see us again or let people, your friends in Vancouver, know, come across and join us then on Saturday the 18th. The other crew member that left, had to leave yesterday when we arrived, was Victoria Sheldon, who's a 25-year-old oceanography major at Humboldt State University. So I want to give both of them applause. Kent Mitchell. We have three other wonderful speakers coming up and some more music. And the speakers are people from Physicians for Social Responsibility, from Living Islands, and from the National Association of Atomic Veterans, so you're not going to want to miss them. We're We're going to have some more David Rovics, but right now we get a break. And we're going to break for 10 minutes, 10 minutes only. I encourage you, believe it or not, the golden rule has a bit of bling. You know, please come by the table here. We have literature, we have t-shirts, we have other things that will interest you. Also, Veterans for Peace has some literature there, and Physicians for Social Responsibility. So please visit the table during the break, and we'll see you in a few minutes. David Aerobics is going to come up and share some more music with us.
The Southern Hemisphere is pointing away to the Northern Hemisphere. It's just that our media won't see it.
Started with some hippies at the Fincraft power station. Debates were held.
nuclear reactor. The majority said no. It could have gone quite different in much of the world it did, except for those elf folk who said we're getting off the grid. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the
world. That's my friend and fellow Benthropies board member Dan Shea to come up and ask you a big question: how far can you dig? The Reverend Dan Shea.
Well, this is going to be short, but one of the things I wanted to say about what we've heard already is, when we're hearing about birth defects or radiation, there's also, for me, it was being called a weapon. So was Agent Orange for me in Vietnam. And I see these things as both the same, that we're fighting the same battle. And I think you need to know that this wonderful trip that they've been doing here has no funding from backers of corporations. There's no foundations that are funding the Golden Rule. It's everybody and every little town that's digging in their pockets and helping fund it. So if you've already donated before, and you can dig a little deeper, and if you don't have it now, of course, you can see here we have the website and stuff on the table. You can donate there. But I'm going to pass this around and ask you to give more, or to pledge more, whatever you can do. You can write an IOU, we'll accept that. Okay, so that's what I want you to do. And we have, like we said, we have more speakers, and we want you to stick around, not just to hear the speakers, but to have a conversation afterwards. And so stick around and you'll be able to talk with people individually. We can come around together and you can tell us why this is important to you. Thank you, and I'll pass it around.
Our next speaker is the anti-nuke point person for Oregon and Washington Physicians for Social Responsibility, Chuck Johnson.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me here and with such a great group of speakers and wonderful musician. Songs I really enjoy. Want to hear more of. I have a public service announcement to make first. I was told by my fellow workers, my colleagues at the Oregon chapter of PSR, that I needed to make sure everyone knew about the commemoration of Hiroshima celebration, or commemoration we do annually at the Japanese American Historical Plaza. This year it'll be on Nagasaki Day, August 9th. Rather than Hiroshima Day on August 6th because of the timing. And that's somewhat appropriate in this region because we're the region that produced the plutonium that destroyed Nagasaki, killed 90,000 people. That plutonium was generated at Hanford in the first production reactor that Enrico Fermi helped design and build up there that was the first atomic weapon that was exploded in the desert in New Mexico, and then was the second atomic weapon used against the people. A genocidal act was committed there. And that B reactor where that material was created is now part of the National Nuclear Weapons Monument that was created by Congress. And one of the things I think we need all of us pledge to do is to make sure that as they develop that monument, that they talk about the people that were killed and talk about people that have been affected by those atomic weapons that were used, and then also by the contamination that occurred as a result of creating all that material. So PSR works on nuclear weapons issues. In fact, we were our original founders in the Cambridge area, Boston area, were involved in this thing called the Tooth Fairy Project back in the early 60s to collect children's teeth to see if there was strontium-90 that was being collected in their teeth to prove to President Kennedy and Khrushchev that indeed there were health effects that were a direct result of atmospheric testing, and it was one of the factors that, that Kennedy cited in wanting to stop above-ground nuclear testing. Unfortunately, they didn't take it all the way. That was accomplished many years later in 1992, but and I'm looking at you for a sign. You're going to point it at me, right?
Okay. I'll turn it around.
So another issue we work on is our climate. We basically, we're focused locally on four issues. Climate change, we have a wonderful organizer, Regna Merritt, and a wonderful group of doctors that are involved in working on that. So we applaud it because you know what great work is being done there. We're working on the nuclear power issue with our colleagues, Mimi and others in the Northwest. We're working on nuclear weapons issue, and I'm glad to see that issue being brought to the forefront again. It's almost like we have amnesia. When the Cold War ended, we didn't want to talk about it anymore. We wanted to forget about it. You know, the submarine base that we have up in Washington, that alone could kill everybody on the planet if all those weapons were used. Just the nuclear winter effect that would result of detonating all those weapons, I believe, would put the entire planet in danger just at that one site. I'm going to talk about something a little bit less dramatic than that, which is the Columbia Generating Station. Mimi's already mentioned that we still have this old GE boiling water reactor. It's of similar design. It's not exactly the same, but it's similar enough that even the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, which doesn't regulate too heavily, is requiring that they put vents into their containment. The problem, what happened in Fukushima was that you had these small, narrow containments that are very vulnerable to a loss of coolant accident. You lose coolant for a short amount of time, and the boiling of the water can cause hydrogen to be formed. The zirconium, as it deteriorates around the fuel rods, divides water into hydrogen and oxygen. The hydrogen forces its way out and can cause an explosion, which is what happened three times in Fukushima. It could happen here with our reactor. They still haven't put in that vent, and they aren't planning to put it in until 2017. We also discovered that the area is much more prone to earthquakes than we knew about. We hired a geologist who worked for the U.S. Geological Survey, and he did an overall study that where he found that the maximum or the maximum likely earthquake is more than double what the plant was likely to be able to withstand, what was rated to be able to withstand when it was originally built. And they've more or less confirmed that with their own study, although they hid the answer in a graph rather than putting it in a conclusion. And they're now in the process of negotiating with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission about what they're going to do about it, which would probably be nothing, judging from how they've dealt with Diablo Canyon and other places that they've known about earthquake problems in the past. I could go on with additional problems. Mimi talked about the fact that Robert McCullough, we hired him to do an economic study, and he found we're losing on average about $100 million in the region just to operate this plant. And this is why plants are closing all around the country. In places where they have to compete, they're losing. And unfortunately, the way our funding for this nuclear plant is structured, the public power utilities built this plant, and they had a contract with Bonneville by which Bonneville is required to buy all the output. Bonneville has 90% of its electricity comes from inexpensive hydroelectric dams. The other 10% comes from the CGS. The cost is therefore masked to the ratepayers, but it's still there, and our rates would be lower if we could close that plant. We've been trying to convince the utilities that are paying those rates. They're complaining about having to do conservation measures that cost them money. They're complaining about other things that cause them to have to raise rates. This is something they could be doing. Closing that plant is something they could be doing to deal with their concerns about rising rates. And finally, we now have one utility that listened to us, which is, and it's because Seattle City Light is a municipal utility, and they sit on the board of Energy Northwest. If some of you have been around here long enough, it used to be called the Washington Public Power Supply System, or WPS. Tried to build five reactors, succeeded in completing one of them, and that's this one that's been running for 33 years. The WPS board is now called the Energy Northwest board. Seattle City Light sits on it, and now they have a position, a goal of closing it and replacing it with carbon-free electricity. They've committed not to build any more new nuclear plants. There are proposals for building small modular reactors at Hanford as well, which have run afoul of state law, thanks to wise people back in the WPS era who said that you have to refer such plans to the voters. And I am out of time. What I would say that, in terms of action, maybe mentioned before that there is this initiative, and it's just getting started. We're not terribly optimistic that we'll qualify this time. Lloyd Marbet, I think, tried three initiatives before he actually qualified one. But it's an educational tool. We urge people to go out and just inform people in Washington that they have a nuclear plan. And then secondly, as Mamie said, we're looking for volunteers and for people who live in the river communities on the Washington side. Most of those have publicly owned utilities that are members of Energy Northwest. Please sign up either on the sheet that's going around or at the table over there and let us know if you're willing to help us out. Thanks a lot.
Chuck, for all your great work and for the great work of Physicians for Social Responsibility. Well, we have a real treat now. The Golden Rule has made a wonderful new friend. She hails from the Marshall Islands. Her name is Kiana Juda-Angelo, and she's the founder of Living Islands, and she's going to tell you all about that. Where are you, Kiana? Is she not here?
Yeah.
Hey, Kiana.
Everybody, how are you doing tonight? Good to see you guys. I just really want to quickly say we had a event, a blessing that happened. We created a outrigger here for our nonprofit called Living Islands. It's just basically to bring awareness about the Marshallese people that are living here in Oregon. We have at least 3,000 to 5,000. Now the word has it that there might be 7,000 people here in the state of Oregon. I wanted to say we have a little surprise for the Golden Rule crew and Helen and her partner. We wanted to gift you guys if you weren't here. But if my lovely volunteer, David Anderson, who's part of Living Islands, could come this way, and Dan as well. Thank you so much, Veterans of Peace, that helped us out. Come on up. We would like to give a Marshallese flag to the crew members and to Helen. Thank you guys for coming up.
and then when we're not using it, we'll just put it away and honor it and keep it with us. Thank you so much. And you know, the connection between the Golden Rule and the Marshall Islands is so manyfold. So I'm so happy that you're here.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, we're just going to really quickly rewind. 43 years ago, okay? 43 years ago, April 27, 1973, there was a baby born. That was me. I was born in the Marshall Islands. And can I have my people come and help me really quickly hold up the map? Sorry guys, I did not do a screen presentation for that map. And I'm just going to show you kind of the distance. I know you can Google that. But the distance from Marshall Islands and where you're at right now. Thank you. So you see yourself in the that orange. You are here in Oregon. Yes. Here's the Marshall Islands, about 3,500 miles away. And there are little dots. And there's a secret military base out there. And that is also where you've heard in the history books about the 65 nuclear warheads that were tested on my island in the Bikini. And there's over 1,000 atoll chains in there, and one of them up here, and I'll keep this map so you guys can refer to it. Bikini is up at the top, and there was three other islands in Wentak and Ronla. And tonight, I'm also excited to have David Anderson here with me. He's also a volunteer. He served in the Peace Corps for 2 years on Inuktitut and Utsalan for back in 75 till 79, help me out here, 77, sorry, math there, 75 to 77, and he learned to speak Marshallese and really engage with the community. And it was on the outer atolls where you have to fend for yourself. Okay, thanks guys for writing this up. This will be over here if you guys want to take a look at it. Okay, so, adopted. I was given to a military family with two other children, two other babies. Three of us were brought over here to Vancouver, Washington, and I was raised here in the Vancouver, Portland area. I was given to the military's family's sister. So both my parents raised me, and I have been here for most of my life until I met my husband, who is from Denmark. Anyways, so 19 years being with my parents, I knew nothing about the Marshall Islands. I was a skier and listened to Def Leppard and listened to all these amazing things. I was not that kind of girl who would wear muumuus or wear boots. And I was just a snow skier, a water skier. I was your average soccer player. And people started to say, Kiana, I think you're pretty sheltered. Do you know where you're from? And I'm like, no, I'm from here. I'm from here. My parents never talked to me really about my people and where I was from and the devastation that happened to my people. So 19 years later, after leaving my parents, I became curious. And I was like, who are these people? What's going on in their lives? So I would research for the last years, many years after leaving, and my heart stopped. And I was frustrated. I was mad. I was angry. I was confused. Here I'm an American. But I'm a Marshallese. Military has, there's that military base that's on my islands. And finding out that there was that testing going on. And finding out after finding my biological family that most of them have died of cancer. And all of the things that go with radiation. And I am just learning, I'm getting back to know my family and understand the culture. And just recently, I had a niece in the Marshall Islands pass away with a sore throat. And this sore throat started to get worse and worse. And and she thought she could go to the doctor. The doctor told her in the Marshall Islands, here, take some Advil. Third, fourth month. Ooh, it's getting a little bigger. Let's give you some antibiotics. Four or five different antibiotics didn't help. It just kept getting bigger and bigger. And she was wanting to go to the College of Marshall Islands. She was excited for her future. Then my government, what we do with people who have issues that the hospitals cannot seem to figure out, we either get them on a plane with one other family member, we get them on a plane either to Honolulu or Guam, and they go to then the hospital, either place. So my niece went, she got that ticket, her mom, my sister, got that ticket, went with her, and they found out that she had cancer, last stage. They said, sorry, you have 2 weeks to live. Go home, just write it out. And that was it. So she took a plane, and they all comforted her as island style, Marshallese culture, as possible, and they just took her in. And they supported her, and they I have to say, these people are resilient. And they still smiled in the end. And they still smile today. And they still push on. And so I decided to make a nonprofit called Living Islands to bring awareness to the people, because I grew up with, where's the Marshall Islands? What are you talking about? Where is that? Is that Hawaii? Is that part of Tahiti? No, it's not. So what we're doing and what we're excited about, Living Islands, it's really bringing awareness here stateside. And we decided to make a boat, an outrigger. And that outrigger will be showcasing in different places here on the West Coast. We hope you can join us. We're looking for more volunteers for support. And we need your help to kind of shout out who we are and let you know we're going to be here with open arms giving you guys hugs. So thank you so much for your support, and thank you, Golden Rule, so much for being here. And thank you, Veterans for Peace. Thank you, guys.
And they told us we were cleared for a very special clearance for top secret, which made us all feel good. And we found ourselves at the nuclear test sites at Christmas Island. And that was in 1962. And after several of the blasts, as we were steaming away from the island, I can remember myself saying, "We've got to have a clean bomb. My government would not do this to me." And I found out, yes, they would. And they did. And we were just veterans that were nuked. And we consider ourselves test site guinea pigs. Just like the Marshallese, they were nuked. But their homeland was also nuked and destroyed. So about a year and a half ago, we had our Linn County here in Oregon representative, when the Marshallese went to talk to her about some help, she says, "Boy, you better find Fred Schaefer and visit with him." And since that point, we have been here to support the Marshall Islands. We went to the state capitol and we testified for them to help them get some recognition. When we were, after we left the island, we were threatened with treason if we talked about it. And in 96, they released us from that top secrecy. I was Oregon State Commander back in the 80s. The Nuclear Association for Atomic Veterans was formed in 76 by Orville Kelly and his wife, Wanda. And shortly after that, I got involved. And we had meetings here in Oregon, in the Portland area, and in the Mid-Willamette Valley. Every 3 months, we had meetings. And that's been going on pretty much for about roughly 20 years. And in a small town like Lebanon, at 14,000, we've been holding these meetings. And every once in a while, a new person will show up, and they'll tell us, "Hey, I didn't know we could talk about this. Even my family don't know I was involved." And still to this day, and there's a lot of atomic veterans out there that don't know that they have the right to talk about it. They think they're still under the Treason Act. Just the other day, a film was released at New York Times, and President Clinton was apologizing to the atomic veterans. And they were supposed to have a good news section on it that evening. And it was the same night the verdict for O.J. Simpson was given. And I think they got about 15 seconds to talk about the apology from the United States to the atomic veterans. Still, a lot of them don't know that that existed. I remember I heard about it, but I long forgot about it until we saw this video again where he apologized. So we're just making headways, and we're helping everybody. This Veterans for Peace is a movement that we like to get involved in. The more, the merrier. We've opened up our membership to the nuclear veterans. They're the boys that went there in 1977, and they started picking up the contaminated soil, putting it in a dome, 10-foot thick of concrete, and now that dome is cracking, and it's leaking into the bay, into the area, and they've got their problems, and there's fewer of them, and they're having more serious problems. And today, the people that are shooting depleted uranium ammunition out of tanks and weapons, which makes them bunker busters. They tell them, my wife had two sons in Iraq, both of them were in tanks, and they were told, if you have bladder problems or kidney problems, get out of the tank, get away from that tank for a bit, it'll go away. Now, sorry, it's not gonna go away. So we're finding more and more. We have 26 presumed cancers that the VA says they won't honor them. Congress has given us 46, but VA won't give us those 46. They'll give us 26 of them. But it's still a fight. But we still have the opportunity, if you have had cancer, And some of those that are the presumptive cancers, there's a class action lawsuit that the atomic veterans or anybody could file and get that $75,000. And we found out last year in Nevada that the miners group will back that up with another $50,000 if you got that $75,000, if you just apply. So there is some compensation coming. But I say we need to make it available to the Marshall Islands, make it not just the atomic veteran is test site participants. So we're trying to include the nuclear veterans. We want that. We have a bill before Congress right now that should become, hopefully it gets voted on and it happens, along with the service member. So we get a worker. Thank you very much.
Okay, so that's the end of our speakers for the night, and Helen's gonna give us a little more information. So the golden rule is gonna be continue sailing for a nuclear-free world and a peaceful, sustainable future. And we have a bunch of activities actually just in the next few days here in Portland, then the next 10 days around the Columbia River, and then for the next 4 months all throughout Oregon, Washington, and British Columbia. And Helen's going to give you a little bit more information about those upcoming events.
We're expecting the parade of Navy warships to be here from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. tomorrow. We're going to meet in Tom McCall Park at 2 p.m. and pass out flyers to the public so they know that the peace ship is out there and what we're all about. And then there will be some kayakivists out on the water with the Golden Rule to greet the Navy warships. The captain of Captain Norm Peterson and Captain Jeff Burke told me as they came in that they actually led the Canadian warships as they came up the river today. and then on June 10th, Friday, we'll be at the Multnomah Friends meeting, 4312 Southeast Stark in Portland, for a potluck. We'll be sailing on the river.
6:30 and everybody's invited.
Everybody's invited.
What time?
6:30. On Friday, 6:30. It's a potluck, yeah. Come chat with the crew and just enjoy everybody's company and friends.
Would you give just a moment? Well, how would you describe the Golden Rule? I don't what does it look like?
Okay, it's a sailboat. It's got a giant, it's got red sails, bright red sails. And one of the sails has a giant peace symbol on it in white. And the other big sail has a giant Veterans for Peace logo in white. It's a catch, so it's got two mainsails, and we've got a jib in the front, and it's 34 feet long, almost 12 feet wide, sleeps four people.
It's on our shirt.
Oh. we're going to leave on Sunday and go up towards Cascade Locks. I'm expecting on the 13th that we might have a little picnic at Cascade Locks when we get there. And then we're going to go up further up the river. And on June 15th at Hood River, we're going to meet at Riverside Church. We're going to have a potluck in the park before we go up there. We're going to have a water blessing. And then we're going to go up to the Riverside Community Church Sanctuary, 317 State Street in Hood River from 7 until 9 p.m. for a panel presentation with music, just like here. And then Thursday, June 16th, we'll be in Stevenson at the United Methodist Church Fellowship Hall, 325 Northwest Jefferson from 5 till 7 p.m. That'll be a potluck and then a presentation. Then we'll be in Vancouver, June 18th from 6 to 8 p.m. at the Clark County Public Utilities Community Room, 1200 Fort Vancouver Way, for a panel presentation and discussion. June 19th, we leave for Washington State. Our first stop will be in Fort Townsend. June 26th, we're going to do a kayakivist and other boaters and the Golden Rule to protest against the munitions depot at Indian Island right across from Fort Townsend, where they load up all of the munitions to go to the wars in the Middle East.
Wow. There it is.
We're going to be in Paulsbo at the Kitsap Regional Public Library. I'm going to be at the CBEC Fellowship of Reconciliation Conference at the same time as the Golden Rule is going to be at the Center for Wooden Boats on Lake Union in Seattle. We've got 4 wooden boat shows this year, 2 in Canada, we'll be in Vancouver and Victoria, 1 in Port Townsend and 1 on Lake Union. We've got several different water actions planned. You can go to the website, bfpgoldenrollproject.org, and there's a link there to this spreadsheet that talks about our schedule. We'll be returning to Humboldt Bay on about October 15th, so it's a long schedule with lots and lots of stops and lots of people to talk to.
Let's give a show of appreciation to all of our wonderful panelists tonight. Well, that was a lot of talking, though, with a lot of speakers. It's hard to do that all in one program. It's a little after 9 o'clock right now. I don't know about you, I've kind of talked out. So I think we'll save the discussion for informal after the program. And instead, we'll finish with a song from David Rogers.
That's the first time I've ever witnessed such an intelligent decision be made at an event involving 6 wonderful speakers. Far away, just over a year ago today.
say you may leave, or you may kill us all. There's no way they could have known that this time, this act of solidarity would see the gunmen leave, those left unachieved on the border there in Mandera County. But sometimes you take a chance that at a second glance you see you've changed the world with the passing of a shawl. There are those who will remember, those who won one day in December said you may.
Thank you for being here. Follow the golden rule.